This kind
Screen is visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Starting the
This conference will now be recorded.
Okay. Guys, am I audible? Hello? Hello? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Screen is visible, right?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay. Coming to the today's topic, our topic is Rh negative pregnancy. Now it is visible.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Hello? Hello? Guys, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
The screen is visible, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Coming to the today's topic, it is Rh negative pregnancy. The introduction, Landsteiner and Wiener in the year 1940 discovered the specific unknown antigen on the human red blood cells, and it was also present in the rhesus monkeys. The antigen was named as Rh. The individual having the antigen is called Rh positive, and whom it is not present is called Rh negative. Incidence of Rh negative pregnancies is 5 to 10% in the South India, it is 5%, and it is in North India, it is 10%. Coming to the next slide. Rh system, it includes of 5 red cell proteins or antigens. Those are capital C, small c, capital D, E, and small e. D is the most potent immunogen and expressed early in the gestation. Based on the father's genotype, it might become a heterogeneous or homogeneous. What do you mean understand by heterogeneous and heterozygous and homozygous is, if we are thinking of 2X, if there are 2X, then it is 100% homozygous. If there is 1X and one some Y, then when considered 2X, it is heterozygous. When considered to the whole cell, it is heterozygous cell. When considered to the each genome, it is 50% X, 50% Y. If no D antigen, then it is called D negative, that is Rh negative pregnancy. Rh, that is a recess. Rh is described, the term is coined because the same antigen is located in the rhesus monkeys also. So from the spelling of rhesus, Rh is taken to name that antigen. Because of the misconception that red cells from the rhesus monkeys express the same as human blood group antigen. In the transfusion medicine, rhesus is no longer used. The CDE system is used. Alloimmunization is defined as the immune response generated in an individual of one species by alloantigen from different individual of same species which recipient lacks. It occurs in two stages, one is sensitization and one is immunization. It occurs due to mismatched blood transfusion or a pregnancy in which the mother is Rh negative and the baby is Rh positive. The screen is sliding, right?
No, hello, ma'am.
The screen is not visible.
Visible, ma'am.
It is moving. Like whenever I'm changing the slide, are you able to see change of slide, right? New slides.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. The clinical importance is the Rh complicating pregnancy. The prevalence ranges from 0.5 to 0.9% in total pregnancy without anti-D immunoglobulin prophylaxis, a D negative woman delivered a D positive, there will be ABO incompatibility for the newborn, which has 16% of likelihood of developing alloimmunization. 2% will become sensitized by the time of delivery, 7% by 6 months postpartum, and the remaining by 7% will be sensitized and will be able to produce detectable antibodies only in the subsequent pregnancies. If there is ABO incompatibility, the D alloimmunization risk approximates 2% without any prophylaxis. The fetal Rh antigens appear as early as 38 days of conception. That is, if the mother is negative and baby turns out to be positive in that pregnancy, the antigens will appear by 38 days of conception. Fetal blood group can be confirmed as early as 9 weeks by trophoblasts from the CVS, that is chorionic villus sampling, and 18 weeks by amniocytes from amniocentesis. All of you know what is CVS and what is amniocentesis, right? These both are invasive procedures to know any diseases which are present in the baby. Chorionic villus sampling can be done from 9 weeks to 14 weeks so that we can identify any abnormality of the baby, such as any cystic fibrosis, any Down's, Crohn's and all. Here we remove the trophoblastic cells. Amniocentesis is from 14 weeks to usually 18 weeks, they say. Here we put a catheter into the uterus, into the amniotic sac, where amniotic fluid will be removed, and in that, from the amniotic fluid, amniocytes will be cultured and tested for the syndromic babies or of any test. This is called amniocentesis, and chorionic villus sampling is done from 9 to 14 weeks, whereas amniocentesis is done from 14 to 18 weeks. After that, we go for a cordocentesis. That is, from the cord, we will be removing the cells and testing that. Circulating cell-free fetal DNA in maternal plasma is a non-invasive procedure. This is what are these are, see, these come under procedures to rule out any abnormality in the fetus. What are those two types? One is non-invasive, invasive. In non-invasive, what are the things usually we see is blood and ultrasound. What are the blood tests which we do? Beta HCG, our alpha fetoprotein, and all these triple markers, quadruple markers, and double markers. And other than those markers, we go for a cell-free fetal DNA, where in a maternal blood, there will be few fetal DNA, fetal blood cells. Those will be removed, cultured, and tested for further evaluation and ruling out of any syndromes. These are all non-invasive procedures. Invasive procedures are our CVS and amniocentesis. So, as we come to know that fetal Rh antigen appears by 38th day of conception, as early as 9 weeks, we can know the fetal blood if we want through a CVS or amniocentesis. This is a phase one sensitization and immunization. See, this is the Rh fetal. Rh positive fetal RBC cells which cross the placenta enters the maternal circulation where Ig enters the maternal circulation. But if the IgM is present in the mother, IgM cannot and does not cross the placenta. Pathophysiology of alloimmunization. ABO incompatibility, that is the Rh positive fetal cells enters the mother's blood cells. They remain in the circulation for the remaining lifespan, after which they are removed from the circulation by reticuloendothelial system and are broken down with the liberation of antigens. These antigens evoke the maternal antibody production, which are formed against the fetal erythrocytes, which crosses the placenta like this and enters the maternal circulation. Thus, the IgM and IgG antibodies are produced to cause the fetal red cell lysis and anemia. Detectable antibodies usually develop after 10 to 16 weeks following the larger volume of fetomaternal blood. But if a fetomaternal blood is less than 0.1 ml, the antibody may not be detected until boosted by further Rh stimulus. Two types of antibodies are formed, which one is the IgM and one is the IgG. IgM is the first to appear, which indicates a recent infection. The other properties of IgM are, these are the large molecules which cannot cross the placental barrier, but therefore no harmful to the fetus. Whereas IgG appears in the later period after the IgM, which are small in size when compared to IgM and crosses the placental barrier and affects the fetus, causing red blood cell lysis in the fetus and following which anemia occurs in the fetus. Antibodies once formed remain throughout the life and will not have any effect on the Rh negative fetus. IgG develops after 6 months. Meanwhile, baby will be delivered. So, chance of first baby getting affected is less. Next pregnancy is due to anamnestic response. IgG crosses the placenta and damages the fetal red blood cells, causing manifestations of all your hemolytic diseases of the fetus and newborn, that is anemia, jaundice, and all. The degree of agglutination and destruction of the fetal red blood cells, various types of hemolytic diseases appears. These are loosely termed as erythroblastofetalis. What is grandmother theory, which is an important question in Rh negative? Grandmother theory is, now we are talking what mother will be negative, baby will be positive. This is we are talking about that Rh negative pregnancy. So in the first pregnancy, the baby is positive, then it might affect the mother. In subsequent pregnancies, baby will be affected. This is normal Rh negative pregnancies, complicating pregnancies, which we are worried about. But there is one more theory called grandmother theory, where even the first child can be affected. In usual normal Rh negative pregnancies, first child will never be affected because it takes some time for the IgG to cross and infect the baby. By that time, baby will be delivered. So that will remain in the mother as a memory. And when subsequent pregnancies occurs, it will go and damage it, because if subsequent pregnancies are negative. But in grandmother theory, even the first child will be affected. How? Like this. If a grandmother is Rh positive and mother is Rh negative, say where if the same mother, see, suppose a grandmother is Rh positive mother, which she has delivered a baby, her daughter, where daughter is Rh negative and she has been sensitized in the she was carrying her first baby, that is Rh positive fetus, then what will happen to her when she is pregnant for the first time? This positive will affect the baby. This is called isoimmunization. This is grandmother theory. Factors affecting alloimmunization is, even though prevalence of Rh negative pregnancy is more, Rh alloimmunization is uncommon because of the following reasons. What are they? Immunological non-responders, insufficient transplacental passage of fetal antigens or maternal antibodies, coexistence of ABO incompatibility, which leads to the rapid clearance of fetal erythrocytes by the reticuloendothelial system, variable antigenicity, variable maternal immune response to the antigen, volume of fetomaternal hemorrhage that occurs, which provokes the antibody response in the mother. What do you mean by fetomaternal hemorrhage is the amount of blood from the fetus which is entering into the mother. This is called fetomaternal hemorrhage. Suppose we'll calculate like 1 ml, 2 ml, 3 ml, 5 ml. Because we have to know how much of ml of fetal blood has entered the maternal system will give you an answer for the following subsequent consequences in the mother. Because they say the more the fetomaternal hemorrhage, the more the response in the mother, so consequences will be bad. That is called fetomaternal hemorrhage. Sensitizing events are like this. Antepartum events which contributes to alloimmunization is first and second trimester miscarriage. What do you mean by alloimmunization? Here means the amount of blood, the same fetomaternal hemorrhage, the how much ever amount of blood is flowing from the baby to the mother, that will provoke the events in the mother. So what are the conditions where the mother can have alloimmunization is during the miscarriages. Why during the miscarriages? Because from the placental bed, some amount of blood from the placenta can enter into the uterus, thus taken into the maternal circulation. So these are the conditions where sensitizing events can occur, that is miscarriages, ectopics, while doing your chorionic villus sampling, amniocentesis, or fetal blood samplings, or any external cephalic versions while you are doing, there might be a chance of small hemorrhage occurring, such as an antepartum hemorrhages, both abruption and placenta previa, any abdominal trauma. These are all the sensitizing events which can lead to a fetomaternal hemorrhage, thus leading to the fetal bed entering into the maternal circulation, thus provoking the antibody response and sensitizing the mother. The incidence of fetomaternal hemorrhage increases with the gestational age and highest during the delivery time. The risk factors for excessive postpartum fetomaternal hemorrhages are cesarean delivery, manual removal of placenta, intrauterine manipulations, multiple gestations, APH, stillbirths, and IUDs. One fetomaternal hemorrhage is recognized. The volume of fetal blood loss should be estimated. The volume is essential to calculate the appropriate dose of the anti-D immunoglobulin for prophylaxis. As we have earlier told, the volume of fetal blood entered into the maternal circulation should be calculated, because that will give us an idea for giving the appropriate dose of anti-D, which will neutralize the antigens and antibody reaction, and also which will give us a key idea to know what is the consequence of the pregnancy. To estimate everything, we have to know how much of fetal blood has entered maternal circulation. For the estimation of the fetomaternal hemorrhage, there are two tests. One is Kluwer-Betke test. It is a quantitative test. It will give you clear idea how much of ml of fetomaternal hemorrhage has occurred. The principle behind this is differential restoration of acid elevation. Here, fetal blood is 5 ml, suppose 4 ml of, suppose you have taken some 5 ml of maternal blood and you have added this as this dye. 80% of ethanol, hematoxylin and eosin, that is the acid citrate fixed. And you have seen under microscope, if you have seen 80 fetal erythrocytes in 50 low power fields, it will be equal to 4 ml of fetomaternal hemorrhage. If you have seen here 160, then it is 4 into 2, 8. So 8 ml of fetomaternal hemorrhage has occurred. This is how the fetomaternal estimation, hemorrhage estimation is done. But how you will know whether it is a fetal erythrocyte or maternal erythrocyte is when you put this dye, the fetal HB is resistant to the acid citrate used. So it is like normal red cell. The adult dye is susceptible. It will be like a ghost cell. Ghost cell is outside the cell, there will be a lining, but inside it will be empty. So based on that, we will be calculating the fetal blood cells. And if they are 80 in 50 no power fill, it is equal to 4 ml. If it is 160, it is equal to 8 ml. The same way, you have to be estimating the how much ml of fetomaternal hemorrhage has occurred. One is the flow cytometry, where it is more sensitive but accurate than KB test, where you will be keeping the blood into the tubes and the cytometry machine will be activated. That will give you a list. Fetal manifestations, if fetomaternal hemorrhage occurs, are hydrops fetalis. Hydrops fetalis is the same like anemia related, because these antibodies enter into the fetal blood circulation through the placenta. They cross the placental blood-brain barrier. They start invading the red blood cells in the fetus. Thus, anemia occurs. Icterus gravis navitarum, that is due to anemia, breakdown of RBCs. Your bilirubin level increases. One more is congenital anemia of the newborn can occur. Hydrops fetalis, it is the most serious form of RH hemolytic disease. In the fetus, excessive destruction of fetal red blood cells leads to severe anemia, tissue hypoxia, and metabolic acidosis. Thus, it shows adverse effects on the fetal heart, brain, and placenta. Hyperplasia of placental tissue occurs in an effort to increase the transfer of oxygen, but available fetal blood cells are progressively diminished due to hemolysis. Why there should be a hyperplasia of placental tissue is, usually initially what happens, the antibodies will be normally gets transported, passed through the placental barrier and entered the baby. But once it enters the baby, it starts invading all the RBCs here and causes a lysis. When lysis occurs, what is the next consequence, sequelae? There will be hypoxia of all the tissues. So it will send similar saying that my baby is not having enough oxygen. So what this placenta will do? Placenta in supposed to produce more, I mean supply, tries to supply more oxygen to the fetus. So it starts in the uterus, it starts proliferating, and it thinks that after proliferation, when its size becomes big, it will increase the transfer of oxygen. That is why in Hydrops fetalis, we see the hyperplasia of the placental tissue. Liver damage occurs due to fetal anoxia, leading to the cause of hypoproteinemia, which is responsible for generalized edema, ascites, and hydrothorax. That is the hydrops. RH positive male fetus are more likely to become hydrops and to die. There will be an accumulation of extracellular fluid in at least two body compartments. Fetal death occurs sooner or later due to cardiac failure. This is a diagram showing the hydrops fetalis baby, where there is a swollen liver, abdominal distension, because fluid will be collected in the extracellular compartments. The diagnostic feature to rule out, to diagnose the whatever it is, hydrops fetalis, is the mother is RH negative. Serological examination reveals of presence of antibody, maybe presence of polyhydramnios under ultrasound. USG, when we are doing, there will be a polyhydramnios, detection of skin edema. What they do is, when they are scanning, they will see, there will be a, if abdominal wall is more, abdominal circum, see how a scan machine will detect the weeks of gestation. Scan will put a probe like this. If it is a round, they will take two dimensions, which will give you approximate age of the gestation age of the fetus. But if the dimension of the abdomen is more, then they will see the skin thickness. Then it will give you an idea whether it is an abdominal swelling, abdominal fluid collection, so it has become more, and there is abdominal wall edema, or if the size of the baby is more, it gives you a clear idea. In USG, to detect the edema in the skin, scalp, or pleural pericardial effusion or echogenic bowel, Buddha position of the fetus is more, where patient will be sitting like a Buddha in the body, and everything will be fully edematous, like everything will be more than the gestational age. Then this will give you a diagnostic feature and ultrasound. Baby appearance will be pale edematous with enlarged abdomen due to ascites, that is a fluid collection in the abdomen. Placenta appears to be very large because why it has to be more large is it will struggle itself thinking that if I enlarge more, if I get hyperplasia more, I have so that I can transfer more of oxygen into the baby. So it starts hyperplasia and appears to be more big in size, large in size, pale edematous with fluid oozing from it. Placental weight will be equal to the fetal weight. Undue persistence of Langerhans layer with a marked swelling of villi can be seen. If the fetus is not hydropic, the placenta usually appears normal. Iterus gravidarum, one more sequelae in the fetus. It is less severe form. Baby born in this condition, born alive without jaundice, but soon develops jaundice within 24 hours. While the fetus is in utero, there will be liberation of unconjugated bilirubin, which processes the placenta into the maternal system due to the destruction of the fetal red cells. A portion of bilirubin enters into the amniotic fluid through skin, placenta, or cord. After cord is clamped, bilirubin concentration increases in it due to the continuous hemolysis. Why hemolysis occurs? Because the antibodies produced, which has crossed the placenta, will be continuously destroying the fetal red blood cells. So whenever the RBC cell gets damaged, there will be release of bilirubin. Whenever there will be release of bilirubin, baby tends to develop jaundice. Liver of the premature baby fails to conjugate the excessive amount of bilirubin to make it soluble and non-toxic so that it can be excreted. But if the bilirubin rises to a critical level of more than 20 mg per 100 ml, it crosses the brain barrier to damage the basal nuclei of the brain, permanently producing manifestations of your kernicterus. One more condition is congenital anemia of newborn, mildest form of the disease where hemolysis is going on slowly. Although the anemia develops slowly within the first weeks of life, jaundice is usually not evident because it is very mild. It means a very less fetomaternal hemorrhage has occurred. Destruction continues up to 6 weeks after, which where there is no AB are not available for hemolysis. AB is the antibodies. So liver and spleen usually enlarge the sites of extramedullary erythropoiesis also. The effects on mother: increased incidence of preeclampsia, polyhydramnios, macrosomia baby, PPH, maternal syndrome such as generalized edema, proteinuria, cruritis, that is cholestasis, is commonly seen. What are the things we have to prevent to prevent the fetomaternal hemorrhage? To prevent the active immunization, by administrating anti-D, that is IgG antibodies, within 72 hours of the delivery to the mother is routinely practiced now, so that mother, if the same mother will have a second baby, then there will be no isoallo immunization. Routine antenatal anti-D prophylaxis also will be given to patients. Those are RAADP, that is antigen of 300 micrograms given at 28 weeks to all the Rh negative non-immunized pregnant women. Apart from this, it is recommended to give anti-D should be given after potentially sensitizing, that is even before delivery and after abortion. The dose is we will have usually anti-D of 300 mics, 150 mics. Usually post-delivery, we give 300 mics. In abortion, we give 150 mics. Generally, the dose will be 300 mics, which will protect the mother from fetomaternal hemorrhage up to 30 ml of fetal loss of whole blood. It should be calculated. For more than 30 ml, 10 mics is given for every 1 ml of the fetal blood. If the pregnancy, these are the conditions, all the unsensitized Rh negative women should receive 50 mics of anti-D within 72 hours of induced ectopic abortions, ectopic, small r, CVS, or any first trimester losses. If the pregnancy is beyond 12, then go for 300 mics. To prevent why we have to give anti-D is to prevent or minimize the fetomaternal bleed. Precautions during C-section: avoid excessive blood spillage while delivering the patient. Manual removal of the placenta should be avoided. Immediate clamping of the cord should be done so that more amount of fetomaternal hemorrhage doesn't occur. avoid prophylactic ergometrine because ergometrine is your methogen. If once methogen is given, it causes sudden inflow into the uterine vessels. So fetometanal hemorrhage occurs. USG amniocentesis after proper localization of the placenta should be done to avoid mismatch transfusions. That is your blood transfusion should be avoided if because risk of ABO incompatibility occurs there. Investigations, if the woman is found Rh negative, Rh grouping of the husband to be done. If a husband is Rh negative, no further investigations, because they here there is no chance of baby having Rh positive because both negatives. If the husband is found to be Rh positive, further investigation has to be carried out, which aims to detect the whether the woman has already been immunized to Rh antigen, to forecast the likely affection of the baby, to anticipate and formulate the line of management of a likely affected baby. Obstetric history. If a woman is primary gravida with no previous history of blood transfusions, it's quite unlikely that the baby will be affected. In a Paris woman, a detailed obstetric history has to be taken. History of stillbirths, neonatal deaths due to severe jaundice following one or two uneventful births is quite suggested. History of prophylactic administration of anti-D immunoglobulin following abortion or delivery should be enquired. Antibody detection test. In the cases of Rh negative women, irrespective of blood transfusion, blood grouping and parity, IgG antibody is detected through indirect Coombs test. If indirect Coombs test is positive, it should be supervised in the centers to rule out, to tackle all the problems of both maternal and fetal, such as your erythroblast fetalsis, congenital anemia of the baby, and icterus neonatorum. In a mother also, all your preeclampsia, polyhydramnios, PPH and all. If it is negative at 12th week, primary gravida, again ICT has to be repeated at 20 and 28 and 36 weeks. If multigravida, repeat weekly up to 24 weeks. Thereafter, after 24 weeks, for every 2 weeks. If anytime it becomes positive, then go for your RAADP prophylaxis. That is one at 28 weeks, after 36 weeks, and delivery. Because the half-life of anti-D is only 6 weeks. So if you are giving at the 28 weeks first dose, it will say two types of protocols will be there. Either you give at 32 weeks, 300 micrograms, and at delivery, 300. Or 158, 28, 32, 150, and then at delivery. Because the half-life is only 6 weeks, so whatever anti-D you are giving, it will be only protecting till 6 weeks. So if you are giving at 32 weeks, your term will be 38. So you think that it is protecting till 38 weeks. So during delivery, you have to give one more anti-D to neutralize the all the antibodies. That's it. Intrapartum management. In unimmunized mother, pregnancy should not be made post-dated, that is after 40 weeks. In isoimmunized mother, time of delivery depends upon the previous history of stillbirth, sudden rise of antibody titer, or optical density difference at 45 nanometers as plotted in the Lilly's chart, or USG or Doppler changes. If you come to know that if there is a mild affection of pregnancy, can be continued up to 38 weeks. If there is severe affected pregnancy, that if the baby is having all the changes, then after 34 weeks, pregnancy can be terminated after giving a steroid. Coverage, less than 34 weeks, if you can wait, you can wait. Or if you think that it is very severe, blood transfusions can be done till 34 weeks and then termination can be done. Mode of delivery, usually if affected baby, it is C-section. That is your severely affected conditions where premature termination is required, or any obstetric indication there, go for C-section, or you can allow for a normal delivery if there absolutely no effect on the baby or mother is seen. The do's and don'ts while conducting a delivery or a planning is careful fetal monitoring cash should be done, gentle handling of the uterus should be done, avoid your giving methogen after the delivery of the shoulder. Avoid manual removal of placenta. Early clot clamping should be done so that to avoid, all these are to avoid the fetomaternal hemorrhage. Cord blood test has to be sent. That is 5 ml will be collected. 2 ml of oxalated HB and peripheral smear is done. To know the baby's ABO compatibility, Rh typing, direct Coombs test to know how much of affected red blood cells are there. reticulocyte count and the bilirubin count in the baby has to be done. Intrauterine fetal transfusion is done, indicated if the fetus is less than 34 weeks, if it is severely affected. Advantages are correction of fetal anemia to improve the fetal hepatic function. Intraperitoneal transfusions such as freshly prepared O negative packed cells can be given. Usually the volume of blood to be transfused in the mother, we usually give 350 ml, but in when coming to the baby, it is not that. It has to be calculated like this. Volume of the blood to be transfused is equal to gestational age minus 20 into 10. That is, if the gestational age is 30 weeks, 30 minus 20 is 10. 10 into 10 is 100. So 100 ml can be transfused. That can be started at 18 weeks, at 1 to 3 weeks interval, up to 32 to 34 weeks. Or this is intraperitoneal transfer. One more is intravascular transfer. Here the blood is transfused into the vascular compartment of the fetus. But this is really little risky because procedures is related to perinatal loss of 7%. Consider steroid coverage after 26 weeks to enhance the pulmonary maturity. The other therapies to treat the fetal complications are plasmapheresis, high dose IV immunoglobulins, donor insemination with Rh negative donor semen. That is, if a mother is negative and baby father is positive, in spite of allowing his semen, we can go for an Rh donor semen so that consequences of all this Rh negative will be removed early stage. Pregenetic diagnosis and surrogacy can be asked if the couple are continuously having any abortions or bad babies. That's it. Breastfeeding is usually not contraindicated because these very little traces of antibodies are excreted to breast. So any Rh mother can be allowed for breastfeeding. That's it for today's class. Guys, am I audible? Are you people listening to the class?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, this is for today's class. Thank you.